Let's talk about this little jaunt I took to India over the winter. The Conway School awards a David Byrd International Fellowship to an alum, and I applied for it about a year ago and received it and got the opportunity to go to Tamil Nadu, which is in Southeast India, over the winter break. And I was tasked with creating an edible landscape for a small community. In a nutshell, I was there for 5 weeks. The community I stayed in is called Sadhana Forest, that's nested in a much larger eco-village called Auroville. And I wanted to just share with you a little bit about my arrival experience. And then I spent 9 days biking around Auroville, had about 3 appointments per day, meeting with different farmers or food systems businesses or entrepreneurs, and then 4 weeks at this small community, Sadhana Forest. And I'm introducing a new element to this presentation tonight, so I have to keep it interesting for me, right? While I was away, I blogged, and I want to share with you, interspersed a couple times throughout the presentation, just some snippets from my blog that go hand in hand with some of the images. And the blog is actually directly from my journal, so it's like sort of firsthand impressions of on the ground in India. And this was, you know, back in December and January, so this kind of is helping to keep it fresh. As I was traveling, I was tasked with looking at our energy system. I was being sent over to India to participate in Living Roots, which is a study abroad in eco-villages program, or at least it has been for several years. Recently was actually shut down right after I left this program. But the course was called Low Carbon Living. It was a 3-week intensive course that I was going to both be a student in as well as facilitate one of the 2 capstone projects, this Edible Pathways project. And as I started going on my journey, I started thinking about how tied in and addicted we are to the grid, right? And sometimes we have these pop-out moments and we realize, oh my gosh, I'm burning all this coal and fossil fuel right now. But a lot of times we just plug right in. So I want to take this opportunity to just read a first part of my blog with this image in the background. As I travel, I am retapping into how vast this world is, how many people, how many flights daily, how many wrappers and coffee cups tossed, how many medications consumed, how many iPhones that go into the trash. On the crowded shuttle bus from Terminal 3 to Terminal 5 in London Heathrow Airport, I was reminded of my brilliant friend and colleague, Dave Jackie, who clearly posits that inside everything we design and create, intentionally and unintentionally, is our worldview. Change that, all systems will change. Keep it static, and it's like pushing a gigantic sled up a steep and slippery hill. So my quest/question is, how do we access the biggest and hardest leverage point for the planet? How do we work on a cultural worldview shift from what Shannon Hayes calls the extractive economy to the life-serving economy? And as I traveled to London, lost my luggage, got delayed, was sent instead of Bahrain to Delhi, to Chennai, without luggage for 10 days, I noticed that we are very obsessed with energy consumption. And here I am in London, but the practices of energy consumption in the West have spread dramatically to India. So I arrive here in India and noticing all of the infrastructure for utilities and the obsession with the new mobile phone. Tons of people ride motorbikes there because it's very arid in Tamil Nadu. It's a really appropriate form of transportation. And there are huge SUVs as well. And huge gas tanks and Indian oil businesses everywhere that fuel these huge government-issued trucks that line up for work to move huge piles of gravel or slag or trash that's along the highway. I love this photograph because it really represents the two technologies coming together, sort of the human-powered transport technology and the new fossil fuel economy. power generation. And these pictures were not hard to find. This was in my taxi ride on the way from Chennai down to Auroville. And then right next to it, you know, you see women who are doing traditional forms of rice paddying. I want to pause there for a second insert. From Chennai to Auroville, the volume of it all, the repeatability and pattern language, colorful boxy building after colorful boxy building, selling of women's clothing, tandoori chicken, cell phone parts. And the highway side, stand after stand, selling motorbike helmets, bags of limes, coconuts. The repeated billboards, the women in their bright saris riding side saddle on the back of their boyfriend's or brother's moped. The India Oil truck and tanks, the rice plantations, the electrical towers and power line cuts. The clumps of cows on the side of the road. The dead dogs lying there, the trash piles, the plantations of bamboo and neem and that still unidentified coniferous evergreen. And I was pretty fascinated with the food system here, and I have a whole other presentation on that, but I just like showing some snippets of what India's food system looks like. It's very decentralized in a lot of ways, still very traditional, and the effects of the World Trade Organization and dumping of cheap imported grains are severely affecting India's food system. And a lot of traditional culturally appropriate foods have been replaced by beef and by soybean oil and a lot of corporate foods into this country that people are being forced to eat. And children sometimes will not even eat food if it's not cooked in their traditional cooking oil. They can taste the difference. And thinking about India's food system and its waste system, there's piles of trash everywhere and they're all burnt. All the trash in India is burnt. So there's tons of dioxins constantly going into the air and you smell it and you're used to it and it almost becomes like an incense. And this photograph is a landfill abutting a drinking water source. So the zoning is very, very different in the sanitation laws in India. And we're going to zoom in a little bit to Auroville right now. Again, I could give a whole presentation on this, but wanted to give you all a flavor of this deeply fantastic and sort of time out of mind and somewhat problematic international eco-village. There's about 2,000 people living here. It was co-founded in 1968. As a collective vision of Sri Aurobindo, Auroville, Aurobindo, who was a native Indian, who was then educated in Britain and came back with a very spiritual philosophy about the oneness of life and how religion is actually divisive and human spirit and unity transcends religion. And then he had a follower, Mira Alfasa, who's also known as the mother, and she was a French woman. And so she had a lot of followers who came from France. So there were Indian followers and a lot of Western Europeans that came together to kind of pioneer in what in the 60s was a wasteland. It was devastated from the effects of colonialism and British rule and deforestation. And so the land was completely barren, the soil was completely desiccated, and they were granted acres and then kept buying parcels in this area to reforest and capture rainwater and sort of redevelop with a lens of sustainability and spirituality. So Auroville is surrounded by Tamil shrines and temples. Tamil Nadu is known for its temples. It's also surrounded by and has in the interior traditional Tamilian villages. And so Auroville employs 5,000 to 6,000 day workers who are Tamilian. And it's a great thing because they're paying them more than minimum wage. It's also a deeply problematic thing because all of the dark-skinned people are doing the custodial work, are picking through the trash, are the maids, are the guards, are the taxi drivers. And it's a really expensive process to become an Aurovillian, so it's self-selecting. And there's a deeply problematic sort of neo-colonialistic structure going on as an outsider. I'm an outsider. I was there for 5 weeks, so I was judging it. But I've heard similar critiques, and in some ways, Auroville is doing incredible things for building schools and health centers and jobs and reforesting. And there's a major, major race divide that was kind of eerie to me. And I was like, oh, are we in British rule before 1947? It seems like it in Auroville. And there was no trash in Auroville, and it was totally safe. And as soon as you bike outside of Auroville, there's trash everywhere. You don't feel safe immediately. So the contrast is really, really striking. This was the arrival into Auroville in the taxi cab. Here I am having my first traditional lunch. And this is called tali. You eat it on a banana leaf with your hands, and you kind of chopped vegetables together with different lentils and chapatis and rice. This is the guest house where I stayed, and it was just a really beautiful place. I made great friends with the maid. She gave me incredible attention as I cried on the phone about not finding my luggage for 10 days. And this is a little bit more in Auroville. There's cows everywhere in the middle of the highway. That's very real. Everyone knows who their milkers are. It's not questionable whose cows are whose. This is a more affluent neighborhood in one of the villages that surrounds Auroville. And there's shrines everywhere, so spirituality and civic life are not partitioned, even though religion is not espoused in Auroville. You see statues of Ganesha and shrines everywhere. This is an example of this is the town center. This is the center of civic life in Auroville. And then the Matra Mandir is the spiritual center. It's kind of crazy to get into. There's a lot of hurdles to actually have access to the interior, but it's a sacred geometric, you know, alignment with celestial bodies kind of building. And this was inspired by the mother, and all the communities of Auroville radiate out from the center. And beauty and simplicity are big values there. I took a picture of this sign because you have to take your shoes off everywhere you go in India, but this place is asking you to keep your shoes on. And experimentation is highly encouraged. It always was from the beginning. Some images of the early days in the late 60s, and using things like cow pee and tamarind, nitrogen fixers to replenish the land. Food and farming is huge there, although they're only consuming 10% of what they grow within Auroville. So in this top image, you see polycultures. You see vegetables mixed in with tree crops, and on the bottom, swales and berms for water catchment during the two monsoon seasons. A lot of energy experiments. So this solar disk here supplies all the energy for the centralized kitchen that produces all of the prepared meals for the guest houses and the schools and the elderly care. Solar street lamps, solar hot water heaters. Water is a super precious resource, so there's a lot of earthworks to collect the rain. Right now, the monsoon, there used to be two monsoons, it's dwindled down to one, so instead of September to December, it's really just November and December right now where they're getting rain, and it's about 34 inches a year in that really short period, so you better store it so it can last. And I thought this was sort of an elegant, it was a wastewater treatment system where they were catching water and using aerobic digestion to treat waste. Fascinating vehicles and bikes for getting around, a really extensive bicycle system in and out of pedestrian trails. And just wanted to highlight a couple of the enterprises that I toured and learned about there. So this is called the Bamboo Research Center. And how it works, basically, and I should say that 45% of Aurovillians are Indians. So it's majority Indian, but these are privileged Indians, mostly, who can't afford to live there and apply. But basically how it works is you get inspired and you're like, I'm interested in researching bamboo. So they say, okay, great. We're going to set you up with the tools you need, and you're going to fix your income rate, and then whatever else profit you generate goes back to Auroville. It's an extremely complicated economic system with benefits and taxes and services. There's service units and commercial units and education units. I can't even begin to go into all of that, but the enterprising piece was really, really fascinating to me. So this is the office at the Bamboo Research Center. This is the different varieties that they're growing and testing for different purposes, like furniture and musical instruments, construction. This is their workshop, so people come from all over the planet to study about bamboo here. And that's true of many of the enterprises. And a lot of the places you can just go and volunteer, and they'll house you in exchange for work. So this is one of the most beautiful staff quarters that I saw while I was there, and I just had to take a picture. The Auroville Earth Institute is also an internationally recognized institute known for its compressed, stabilized earth blocks, which is basically moist, rammed earth set into molds that cools passively and can be used like an adobe, but doesn't have the same embodied energy as, say, cement. So it was this beautiful laboratory with soils collected from all over the planet. It was just, you know, a soil scientist's dream to be in there. And I have so many more pictures, but thinned them out. And working with ferro cement and sort of creating molds for different purposes. This is the earth block building machine, and all of these need to sit out for 24 hours, and then you can work with them. Some of them also have voids for rebar to be used as sort of Lego pieces and built around rebar. And this is an example of what one of the buildings built with these blocks looks like. And because it's very dry there, it's the subtropics, and with the monsoon season, this is a really appropriate building strategy. Trash is fascinating there. It's a huge resource. It's treated very, very differently here. So if you have enough wealth to accumulate things to produce trash, then people come and seek you out. And so how it works is you have trash and you have enough wealth, so that means you also have a gardener and a guard and a maid. And so the maid is the first in the pecking order, and she gets to go through your trash and repurpose and upcycle as she will. It then goes to the gardener, then finally the guard, and whatever is left over, someone comes and picks up your trash and pays you to take it away because it's so valuable. So what's left over goes here to eco services. And as I mentioned, these are local Tamilian women who are paid more than the minimum wage, but significantly less than Aurovillians can pay themselves, and pick through trash and still try to find valuables. And this is a great way to reduce waste. And then whatever else is burned. And then there's, of course, repurposing. Like this man here, his hat that he's showing us was made of the tape reels of cassettes from the 1980s. And this very famous designer has now created these hats in Auroville. But what do you do with biological waste? That's something you can't burn. That's just what happens to, you know, anything from the medical industry. And what's happening now in India is that the maxi pads and the Kotexes of the world have realized, oh, there's 335 million menstruating women in India. What a great untapped market. So traditionally, women bled on cloths and rinsed them out and hung them up, and that was that. But in the last 5 to 10 years, the maxi pad companies have been targeting women in India and saying, well, that's unsanitary, and if you're stuck in the old ways, you bleed on cloth, but why don't you be just like the Western women and use maxi pads? And so we're getting this trash. And I was super inspired. We went and met with the EcoFem Collective, and they create these reusable cloth-based maxi pads that they're selling to women in India, but also in the States. And it's a business model where I think it's like $14 or $15 for a maxi pad, you know, at the co-op, but a significant amount of the profit that's taken in is used to offset and subsidize the cost of distributing them to women in India. So it's a really great social enterprise model, and I patronized her well. I want to look a little bit about at the guest houses before we zoom into Sadhana Forest. Several of the guest houses are growing their own food, generating their own energy. They're way beyond us in the Pioneer Valley. So anyone interested in sustainability on a community scale, there's excellent, excellent case studies here to go and check out. So this is Verite. One of the co-founders actually was involved with a mega institute for a long time. So this place actually felt kind of like a mega in India to me, which was sort of comforting and strange all at once. And I should say all the communities there have these names of human virtues like honesty and certitude and clarity and faith. But these pictures here are actually the names of the bathrooms at Verite. This is their food growing operations. Again, the big larder is sun, the lack is shade, so shade cloth everywhere for growing annual vegetables. They're generating their own power on site. A lot of places dig their own ponds. This is a place called Solitude Farm. It's an organic farm. This is one of the staffing quarters there. This gentleman is sharpening a knife using human-powered sharpener. I love this picture because it juxtaposes the windmill, the solar panel, and the huge cistern for capturing rainwater. And this cistern, you can't quite get a sense of the size of this cistern, but it was like one of those bad dreams and you fall down the hole into nowhere and you can't ever get up, and this was that cistern. This is the laundromat. So you are pumping your water and you're beating it against a slab and then you're letting it dry out in the sun. Using anything you can on site for greenhouses. Everything is put up on these rock pillars because of termites, so you can't let any wood foundation touch the ground. And here they're growing an incredible polyculture, so they're using nitrogen fixers as ground covers, and then rice plantations layered with bananas. So this is sort of like your classic permaculture in the tropics demonstration site. They had one milker for the whole farm, and it's eating the food scraps under a mango tree. And this place just opened a cafe a couple months before I got there. So they have incredible outdoor seating. They're growing all their food on site. They've got a kitchen. They're creating value-added products like papaya jelly. Papaya and bananas are ripe year-round, so there's a lot of papaya to process. Growing their own peanuts and making their own nut butter. And lots of cool stuff, like people who have crafts to sell, like the earrings I'm wearing today were made by someone on the farm, and they're just selling whatever they have. And it's kind of like that in India. You don't go to a store for shoes or a store for cosmetics. There's just different markets and stands set up with whatever you have at the moment to sell. And the last place I'll share with you is Sapni Farm. This is on less than an acre, a permaculture site, where their soil was incredibly dry and pebbly, and using carbon materials and nitrogen fixers and humanure to build up the soil. Sapote was starting to fruit while I was there. So I can't remember his name, this guy who's from Austria who gave me the tour. If you see to the right here, this is what the soil, the parent soil, looked like at the time. And this is the soil that they've built using carbon, nitrogen fixers, and humanure. So speaking of humanure, this is their outhouse. This is what toilets look like in India. And I did not do my research before I went about the loo. So I learned that traditionally what you do is you use the bum wash bucket that everybody uses, and you squat over the toilet, and then you wash your bum with the bum wash, and you use your other hand to wipe. No toilet paper needed, a lot less embodied energy, a lot less embodied water. And different places, of course, have different ways of treating their waste, but this place separated out the poo from the pee. The pee went down a pipe to the biochar that they made right there, and absorbed the nitrogen from the urine into the biochar and then used that again to enrich their soil. And then the poo was composted with lots of leaf litter and carbon in India, 6 months, forget about 2 years here in New England, and that's good to go and put on your gardens. gray water system, growing edible plants from their kitchen water. Bananas ringed the gray water around the showers. And this was their outdoor kitchen. And I was really pleased to see permaculture principals up in their kitchen. And they teach a lot of permaculture courses there and invited me back to say, hey, if you want to teach, we'll be here. So that was pretty exciting. We're about to journey into Sadhana Forest together, which is a fascinating microcosm of humanity. I don't know if you can see, but this is Sadhana Forest's welcome sign as you pull in. It's geographically isolated from the rest of Auroville, so it's a good couple kilometers outside of town and over a huge highway, and you have to go through another Indian village, and then you arrive. And in 2003, Aviram, Yorit, Rosine, along with their daughters, received 70 acres of land with the goal of reforesting it, which is, you know, in keeping with the mission of Auroville. And since that time, they had tons of friends showing up and saying, hey, can we volunteer? How can we help you? What can we do? So it's morphed into one of the largest volunteer communities on this earth. They see between 5,000 to 10,000 visitors a year. At any given time, they can have between 30 to 150 volunteers. And it's all predicated on seva, which is translated as selfless service. So 5 days a week, you have 5 hours of seva. So we get up early, and in the morning from, my gosh, I guess morning circle was at 5:45. So from 6 to 8, you do 2 hours of mostly forest work, and then after breakfast, another 3.5 hours. And then you have a couple of community shifts that happen throughout the week. And a couple of things I wanted to share with you here. Their organizing principles. So it's all vegan organic food. And as a student on this program, I was asked to eat only vegan the whole time that I was at Sadhana Forest and on the program. No money is exchanged except for you pay about equivalent of $5 a day for 3 organic vegan meals. But other than that, you can't bring any money into the community. It's all a gift economy, so it's a pay it forward. Inclusiveness and non-competition, so if you want to play kickball, forget it, you're out. Technical sustainable living, so I'll show you some of those examples in a moment. Unschooling and child-led education. There's tons of families there with tons of screaming children that are in charge of their destiny. And it's also drug, alcohol, and tobacco free, and you're not even permitted to consume any of those things even when you're off of Sadhana Forest land, because you can come and go, you can have your own bicycle or moped, but those things are not permitted. And there are spies in the community that tell on people. Not me, but there was a big admonition group meeting while I was there. I guess somebody had been caught smoking cigarettes in Auroville, and it was a big deal. And let's see, anything else I want you to know? So there's only 0.01% left of the indigenous forest. So here's the tropical dry evergreen forest. And that 0.01% are the rings that are left around the sacred temples. The ancient temples, not the pretty ones I showed you. And that's it of old growth. So they're working to reforest with the tropical dry evergreen species into Sadhana Forest, and I'll share with you my first impressions blog as I arrived. So completely off the grid, totally solar powered, and living well, I might add. Like, we had some incredible, I was there for Christmas, I was there for solstice, I was there for New Year's, I was there for birthday parties. We had DJs, we watched films with projectors. Like, people were living pretty good there. Everything is this teak thatched huts, so open air. And the volunteers who are there for 3 months or longer get a private hut. But if you're there for, they ask for a month minimum commitment during the busy season, you are put in a dorm hut with 40 to 60 other people. And sometimes they'll hang sheets in between 6 beds or so to create rooms. And this was the Living Roots students that I was working with while I was there. And this is what the soil looks like at Sadhana Forest. So they're using the silver acacia from Australia, because it is one of the only species that can adapt and survive in that kind of soil and be a pioneer species. So they're nitrogen fixers, and they're building soil, they're fixing nitrogen, they're creating shade, they're serving as a nurse plant. And they need sun. So as they start getting overcrowded by the tropical dry evergreen forests, they're going to be phased out. And, you know, people have mixed feelings about it. They're not native, they're assertive or invasive. But I'm like, hey, if we're not using this technology, what are your better ideas? So we, you know, right plant, right place. We're using them for a specific function. And they can be cut back and turned into charcoal as needed and other products over time. So this is a picture of the seed, and it shows you the little leguminaceae leaflets coming up. And I want to share with you the diagram of their strategy for reforestation before I show you some of the images. So what they're doing is it's all human ore there. And for a long time, they were digging into the soil, too compacted, too desiccated. So they're berming up now, and they're planting into berms. So this is a foot-wide plastic piping that's just there as a brace to hold the container. Berming up the soil on day one, you're watering. There's humanure in here mixed in with parent soil. And you're watering with effective microorganisms to help stimulate the microbial activity. And you're also digging an uphill swale to help bring in water for passive irrigation. Day two, you are bringing in what they've developed. It's a wick irrigation system. So they use 2-liter plastic bottles with an epoxy seal and a cotton rope wick coming out. They put the bottle for pressure to get some headspace on a little berm. They wrap the rope wick around the roots. They put the plant in. They put more water, fill it up with more humanure, and then you remove the piping and you cover over with tons of mulch, and it's all about evaporation prevention. And you only have to put water in that 2-liter bottle once a week, and you're only babying it during the dry season when you would have expected a monsoon, but it didn't come. So these plants are extremely adapted to this climate. And, here in the States, you know, you want like a first-year establishment, you want to water it for the first year, maybe 2 years, but not with these species. They're not that high maintenance. So this is what it looks like on a larger scale. So we're digging out earth here, which are sort of infiltration basins. We're bunding them up because they call it buns there instead of berms. So we're kind of creating a bathtub lip around the area. And then these are the mulch piles that have the baby trees in them. And I already told you about the monsoons, but it's important to know it's extremely hot here. The average low temperature in January is guess. 75, average low. And it says the average high is 95 in May, but I don't believe it. I think it's getting hotter and hotter and hotter. And Sadhana Forest is only 3 miles from the Bay of Bengal, the Indian Ocean. And it's only 100 feet above sea level. And the nearest city is 5 miles away. It's a small city of 3 million people in India called Pondicherry. But it's important to kind of contextualize this work that they're doing because, you know, thinking about climate change, right, and sea level rising, they are right on the coast. And so maybe they'll be affected, maybe they won't be in terms of the waters. You know, the water probably is not going to reach them, but all of the people who are right on the coast are going to be starting to come inland. So this is actually a really important technology if you start thinking about analogs and not just through the native trees lens, but like what kind of edible fruit and nut trees can we be planting to feed people as they start moving inland. So it's also just important to be thinking about time in terms of wanting to get their technology down in order to spread it. So when I came in, I was like, oh, great. This is a reforestation community. We're going to be growing fruit and nut trees to demonstrate what you can do in this marginal land with that poor soil. As I learned, they didn't want large trees in the residential area where they wanted to have this demonstration site because of termites, because of snake habitat, because of blowdowns. So it became a lot about edible perennials and herbs and shrubs. But I think that this technology really can be expanded to show what you can do with fruit and nut trees. I should also mention that they have, since 2010, started a Sadhana Forest in Haiti and are now starting one in Kenya and working with traditional peoples living in that area in a much more reciprocal accountability, mutual accountability way, rather than we're going to impose what we want, our values, on you. And so those are really exciting projects to check out. And Haiti is so close, and they have an incredible permaculture project down there, and they're working with the Maya nut tree to kind of help both reforest Haiti as well as provide food security. And here's an example of a patch that's grown up for a little bit longer. This is a close-up of the wick irrigation system. This is when they used to dig into the ground. And this is, you know, this is like a 2 or 3 year old tree now that they've started mounding up rather than digging in. Share with you my first impressions of my arrival to Sadhana Forest. There are barking dogs, small with big eyes and likely fleas. There are barefoot people from every background on this globe working in the communal kitchen, cooking over the 4 rocket stoves, cutting tapioca and peeling chow chow, talking, singing, laughing. There is a woman in the kitchen pumping well water into her bucket for a much longed after bucket shower. Ohad, an Israeli man who lives in Sadhana with his wife and 2 children, give me a basics tour. Here's the compost toilets where you separate poo from pee, squatting over holes, wiping with bum wash in the left hand. Here's the hand washing station with biodegradable soap and gray water irrigating the banana trees. Here's the main hut where people eat, host workshops and community meetings. Here's the router for Wi-Fi, powered from solar panels. There is a dishwashing station set up using coconut husks as appropriate sponge technology and ash from the rocket stoves as appropriate soap technology. There is a separate dishwashing station labeled sick people only. No candles, they will burn the teak thatched huts. No food products allowed on site with dairy, meat, honey, or egg. This is a strictly vegan community. No Toms of Maine, it's not biodegradable. Instead, everyone uses a curry neem powder in jars hanging on all the huts. Bare feet, drumming, and pitching in are highly encouraged. I walk into the dorm, a 40-person outdoor living space with a roof and upper-level classroom. Sleeping spaces separated by hanging sheets sleep 3 to 6 people in a rope-woven beds with musty mattresses. The floors are red sand dirt. There are large black slugs slowly moving on the floor. I catch a rat out of the corner of my eye walking in the beams. I take my wormwood and black walnut hull complex and step further into India. So just a little bit of images. Here's the rocket stoves, and they've received a great grant to distribute this technology to local villages in the area because the number one cause of infant mortality is women cooking with their infants on their backs, and the really smoky stoves they use suffocate the babies. So this is a really important upgrade for local villagers. This was Christmas morning, so we had very fancy vegan breakfast. It's a good illustration. We had fruit every day, and there's tapioca in here and some kind of like vegan like biscuit with pomegranate and coconut. And all of the food is separated out from cooked food to raw food to citrus for different composting times. The dishwashing station with the ash and coconut. There was a sanitation dip at the end, happy to report. Although a lot of people had dengue fever before and after I left, and I did get food poisoning once and extremely ill. Outdoor showers. This is the laundromat. This is Aviram here, the co-founder. of Sadhana Forest, the recycling hut, the gray water system where the urine goes afterwards and gets processed. And this just gives you a sense of people everywhere, all the time, speaking different languages and coming from different backgrounds. And it was an incredible party all the time and totally overstimulating for me by day four. And I said, I cannot sleep in a 60-person dorm if you want me to facilitate a capstone project. So I got moved to a special hut, thank goodness. But really quite an experience. So I want to tell you a little more about the project. This is a map of the 70 acres. They wanted to focus in the residential area here because that's where they take their tours through every Friday. And we did a site assessment of, well, where's the most value-added, high-leverage place to do this project. So we looked at all the surplus water sources. That was really the biggest criteria. The hand washing stations had overflowing water. It was even disgusting and creating anaerobic conditions. This was the pit. This thing on the top here was actually a cover. So this was the pit that the rinse water came out of the kitchen from. And this was where they put a bunch of food scraps and mopped the kitchen water into. It was actually eroding the foundation of the kitchen. So water is abundant and not well designed for in this community. And I should, this is a spurious community and has grown without any central planning. So they're doing a good job of what they have, but it's been accreted over time. So we eventually ended up deciding on the area next to the kitchen. It was on the tour route. It was a great place for keeping your eye on growing food and for harvesting, and it abutted the morning circle area, which is where we would gather at 5:45 and sing songs and kind of like get our energy up for the day. So this is the entrance to the morning circle. This is looking in from the outside of morning circle. And we decided on that area. So the next step was I taught everyone in the course the design process. This is the upper level classroom we were at. This was the library, which was above where most of the students were sleeping down below. And we worked with the community and interviewed the key stakeholders who are the long-termers. So the goals were about education for the visitors, about growing food in marginal land in the arid tropics and integrated soil. Something that was low maintenance and reused on-site resources. The food they grew was easily identified and incorporated into the vegan meals. And lastly, it was designed for long-term success well after the students left. And so we decided on the site, and then we started doing site analysis, right? And we were looking at vegetation and soils and aspect and all that. And we couldn't have picked a more perfect site. I mean, I'm coming in, you know, not being a great plant identifier in Tamil Nadu. I'd spent my first 9 days going around and looking at botany books and going to the botanical gardens, but I didn't know a chaya tree from a neem tree. And so here we have chaya and neem right next to each other. Chaya is like a delicious spinach substitute that you can steam to get rid of the cyanide and eat. Neem is incredible, as you all know, for lots of products. And we started taking a tour with Vineet, who is the gardener here. You can see him touching the banana. Those pink dots in the front, that's hibiscus or rosella. He's showing us the banana tree. There was a guava. There was a jackfruit. They said they didn't want trees. Jackfruits are like 40 feet tall. There was papaya on site already. This is moringa or drumstick tree, which is a really popular tree in the tropics. There were nitrogen fixers. There was ginger already there, vitamin leaf, wild pineapples. This was a wild fig. And this is Vineet with the neem tree. So we really scored. We're like, okay, this is actually a project about making the landscape legible. These were sort of the forgotten about plants that they said they want an edible landscape. Well, hello, you have one. You have one right outside your kitchen. So we started base mapping. These were four students I was working with from all over the country who none of them had studied permaculture before. So mind you, this is a 3-week long course. So teaching them the basics of permaculture, organizing the community, coming up with a design, and we did actually have time to install it. So this is the little on-site studio that I'd set up for myself. Just to give you a little tour, People are coming in through the kitchen here. This is where that gray water was coming out and creating a big mess and eroding the foundation. There was already a banana, the rosella, the guava. This is the entrance. This is a big dorm, huge, almost like Phragmites-like reeds growing, so it was blocking visibility in. And then we had the neem and the chaya and the moringa. But there's actually, we didn't get to it, but there's vegetation all along here, and over here there's a big fence. And so this is really the only, right here is the only point of access into this very large circle, and this is the only flat, open area. You're living in a forest, basically. But people wouldn't use it as much as they could because you couldn't see into it, as limited access, and people started treating it like a refuse spot. Like, there was hair cutting, and there was, like, gross hair sheds everywhere, and people put banana peels and orange peels, and, like the ground was all, like, nasty and just partly vegetated and partly sandy, and there's termites. Like, you do not want to hang out in Morning Circle, but because it's the only flat open area, sometimes you go there. And then we started identifying, what are the patterns that are happening throughout the day? Back here, this area was where the compost was over here. They were doing compost rinse. So this is like high mopping time, veggie rinse, water time. So there was another huge on-site water resource that could be directed for irrigation. Look at all of that water there, and it created a huge muddy problem. There was so much water there, they were growing mushrooms in the arid tropics. So we got to work, students had their different layers of analysis. We presented them together. Here we are in the center of Morning Circle. And just check out this overgrown situation with like a crumbling cob bench on the inside, benches made out of tires that were blocking the other two access points. It was just awful. So we came up with a summary analysis, and these are the only other two points, and they're blocked from the benches. And you can't really see in. Big limitations, the soil is poor, shade is a big limitation, the turnover, the transient staff is a big limitation. Great opportunities, there's water, there's already edible plants on site, there are people in the community who are excited about permaculture, it's right next to the kitchen. So the students presented in the main hut their analyses and the goals, and we had maybe about 20 people come to our presentation. Participants gave us their ideas and feedback. It was a really exciting day. And so we presented them to each other. And so then we said, okay, let's go out into the community. We know one of our big lacks is financial capital. So I already had a relationship with Sapney Farm. So I went back to Sapney Farm and said, hey, you guys are doing a good job of growing edible perennials. What can you teach us? What can you share with us? I can't remember this guy's name, but he was sort of a master herbalist. And he gave us the most amazing cutting. So we took some taro, we took ginger, we took turmeric. He gave us something called chicken spinach. Jonathan, do you know chicken spinach? It's an edible perennial that you don't have to cook. You can just eat the leaf right off of the plant. And we went to this another place called Pebble Garden. So this is their native soil. They've been gardening there for 20 years. Bernard and Deepika, again, using the silver acacia. And he said, well, we're going to observe what nature does. So we started looking at the termites. And he said, basically using like the termite strategy for creating habitat for themselves, they mimicked what they were doing. And so using the acacia leaves and termite droppings and charcoal, layering them and creating sort of a dry lasagna garden, layer after layer after layer, and you're soaking the acacia leaves to simulate a rainstorm. Bernard and Deepika were direct seeding into this lasagna garden. And this is the soil that they came up with just using that strategy. And this is their garden from that pebble soil. And they're part of the seed sovereignty movement that Vandana Shiva is spearheading. So they keep seeds, and they gifted us with seeds. So we made donations to both these places, but they share with us their knowledge, their natural capital. A couple of things I want to point out we took as design directions. We're taking down this fence that's here along the north side to let more access and circulation in, sort of like a redesign of an urban park that you want to make safe and accessible again. We're cutting back the visual barriers removing the ugly cob bench, although the community decided they wanted to keep the cob bench. We're asking the compost watering to alternate from different spots so it's not creating a muddy mess, and using it for water to irrigate. Removing the huge trees here. We're berming up the foundation using the water for, you'll see the design moment here. There's a center snag as an eyesore, and we're creating more visibility in terms of how to use the space by cutting back the overgrowth and making what's already there legible. And because it was a demonstration site, we said, okay, how can we demonstrate best practices? So we organized the patches by different soil building techniques. So everywhere you see orange, it's using that lasagna layering with the termite droppings. The green is composted food scraps, brown is humanure, and yellow is a sponge, which I'll show you. It's also called banana circle. I'll show you a diagram of in a moment. That's using woody biomass and water as a sponge to build soil. And then we had different irrigation guilds based on relative location, proximity. So compost rinse was going to be alternated between A and B. We even had people who are toothbrushing right outside the dorm. So if we put something in like holy basil, it doesn't need a lot of water, people could spit their biodegradable toothpaste on there. We had kitchen gray water in this area, and then we used the wick irrigation that I showed you earlier to plant chaya and moringa on the north end. This is the final design. You can't see super well. So this is the new morning circle path opened up. Eventually a path will be opened up as a second phase on this side of the kitchen. And there's bench nooks to have some privacy in a place where there's no privacy. We've opened up this path by taking out the benches and putting them under the neem trees for shade and for a prospect to look in this new park area. We've used this one area that actually has shade as sort of a tea garden. And we've cut back so you can see in, and we've planted edibles on this existing trellis here while leaving the nitrogen fixer. This is just behind the kitchen, so putting in a banana circle and using canna to filter the gray water that's also edible, and just clearing everything out. This area was a salad bar area, so having things you could, you know, chop and eat really quickly, like chicken, spinach, and using lasagna gardening to trellis beans up the shed. And this is that cross section of the banana circle. So digging up 6.5 feet wide, 2 foot deep basin with little shelves and then berms. And you fill it with organic matter like sticks and leaves. And you plant onto the shelves taro, which do well with a little bit more moisture, and bananas, lemongrass, cassava as ground cover. And the idea is the water comes in and the organic matter soaks up the water as a sponge, and slowly that decomposes into soil, but it helps the water retention for the plants that it's surrounded by. And then just a little bit about the lasagna gardening. It's kind of intensive. Go acacia leaves, termite droppings, 4 times back and forth, and then charcoal. And then you repeat that pattern 2 more times, and you direct seed into the top layer while soaking the acacia leaves overnight to simulate the rainstorm. So the students presented the final product to the community. So on a Tuesday, we coordinated a huge community install day, which was terribly exciting to get to. So here I am soaking those acacia leaves the day before. This is not my installation work clothes. We got all the tools out that they use for the reforestation projects. And we started taking down this gnarled, overgrown mass. It was so cathartic. And opening up light. And this guy's important here. This is Orr. He's Israeli. He was a good friend of mine while I was there, but he was really excited in permaculture, and he was going to be there for the next 6 months, which was a long time. So he became the new project manager. So I'm mentoring him this day and giving him the plans and the management plan for him to follow up and steward and take pictures and send them to me. We moved those benches right out of the way and put them in the shade under the neem tree. Isn't that beautiful? We took down, there was a falling down fence on the east side that wasn't blocking access, but it looked really crappy, so we decided to reconstruct it to grow more edible beans on. So here's the fence totally taken down, and then we rebuilt it. took down the ugly snag that was, it was so awkward. Everyone was trying to like play like circle games in the morning, but you're like up against the snag and the circle couldn't get any bigger. So we took that down. Some people had feelings about it. Just removing the overgrowth, the weeds with the mumpty, which is a traditional tool there. Using all this for composting. Everyone has delegated tasks, so we're making trellises, and that's the acacia leaves on the bottom. That's the lasagna gardening. Termite droppings, I had people go out and gather on site. This is the layering. I'm describing to people how to build a banana circle, even though I've never built a banana circle, using crowbars because the land is so hard. So isn't that beautiful? 6.5 feet wide, like almost perfect. And then we brought in the humanure. So we kind of increased the fertility on the ringed berm. We brought in lemongrass from on site. This is Yoav, an incredible ally in this project. And he's one of the project managers at Sadhana. We had people going out and collecting leaves. We put a whole bunch of leaves and sticks in the center. We dug a trench from the kitchen and planted canna, which has an edible root and also filters gray water. In the swale, planted little baby taros on the step, and banana tree sucker. So you can just cut down a banana sucker and just replant it, and then it will give you yields. And here I am, very proud on my second to last day. So this is what it looked like when it was done. People are taking a banana break, and we transplanted a whole bunch of holy basil. This was using the composted food scraps. We found a rogue patch of wild pineapples that we planted around the wild fig tree. And these were cuttings of chaya and moringa, which you can just propagate vegetatively. And the leaves are really delicious and edible and part of traditional foods of Tamilians. That's the chicken spinach and the salad bar I was talking about. So this is the area starting to feel really clean and clear and productive. This is where all that Phragmites reeds had been taken down. And we used coconut shells. This is the new pathway we opened up. And then the very next day was Pongal. And Pongal is a huge rice harvest holiday that for 1 month, in the exact 1 month I was there, they play techno temple music starting at 4 a.m. every single day for about 3 hours with earplugs. And an eye mask. I could not sleep through this. And so Pongal was over, which meant the techno temple music was over, but it was a huge holiday the day after the installation. And Sadhana invited their local Tamilian neighbors to come in and have this celebration in the morning circle space. And we couldn't have planned it more perfectly. It was like, build it and they will come. And so all these people started coming into the space and beautifying it. We had huge sugar canes. We had fires and games going on. They're preparing here. And look, all these people suddenly populating the space that had been totally devoid and underappreciated. People are using our new benches. That's the guard, by the way. He eats only bananas. Here's everyone hanging out and laughing and eating. And so it was just this amazing boon to leave with, just feeling so incredible. And there's a metaphor here. You know, we take this crappy soil that's been so harmed and feels irreversible by things that our ancestors or somebody else's ancestors did, that we get handed down this legacy, and it feels so hopeless and heartbreaking. But what can we do? What can we do together as community? What can we do looking at traditional practices? What can we do learning from nature and small organisms such as termites and bring this together to really regenerate and repopulate and revegetate with a Garden of Eden village? So this was incredibly inspiring to me. And if you take anything from tonight, it's this possibility for renewal and not to underestimate any of the power that any of us thinks that we do or don't have, because it's extremely powerful. And when we work together in community, things like this can happen. So I just want to leave you with all of that and the delicious abundance here. So thank you.